But now I want to talk about this most important word that's missing from here, which was linear. Linear. Are they linear? What would it mean for them to be linear? And how would that help us to solve them? Well, I won't hold you in suspense. I can tell that the suspense is just killing you. So yes, they are linear. And here's the simple thing that it means. If I imagine that there are two different functions that satisfy this equation, two different harmonic functions, and I add them together, will they still satisfy the same equation?
Yes.
I don't even want to discuss it because it's so obvious. Discussing it will make it seem complicated. But you look here, and if you have two functions and you take their second derivatives and then add together the second derivatives, here I am discussing it. It's like adding the functions first and then taking the second derivative. So the second derivative always factors out. Of course they're linear. Of course it is a linear function. So I always make this discussion a little bit incomplete because you should also ask the question, if I have one function that satisfies this equation, would a scalar multiple of that function, a number times that function, also satisfy this equation? And the answer is just as clearly yes. I see lots of thumbs up. So yes, this is a linear equation. It is also, now that it's linear, I can now start using a lot of the linear algebra terminology. This is a question of the null space, isn't it? This says, find a function in the null space of the Laplace operator. Okay, that makes us more comfortable, I think. Just, you know, it's almost like AX equals zero. It has that feel of AX equals zero. And if this is AX equals zero, that's the linear algebra analog, then what's the linear algebra analog of this? AX equals B. So I don't have too much space to write it, but I think it deserves to be written down. AX equals zero here, that's Laplace's equation. AX equals B here. There you go. And so now you kind of know if you were to start, let me back up half a step and say, this gives us a little bit of hope in thinking about how we would solve these problems. Because we can start in a way building our solutions up from the many, many functions that have this property. Because if two functions satisfy this equation, then their sum satisfies this equation. So you start thinking about solving these problems by decomposition. You will say, I will find one function that satisfies this equation. Not so hard. X squared minus y squared. Would you agree? Equals zero, the Laplacian of this function equals zero. That's just one example, but of course, there are more than infinitely many. 2xy, x cubed minus 3x squared y. So easy to think of, take any one of them and shift them. I can think of a combination with sines and cosines just so that you get a minus sign in one and not in the other and they totally cancel each other perfectly. I can think of a lot of things. And my strategy would be to just find as many of these as I can. They all satisfy this equation, but remember, the hard part is the boundary conditions. And then I'll start putting them together in just the right combinations to satisfy boundary conditions. And as long as I deal only with harmonic functions, I don't have to worry about this being satisfied. This becomes the easy part. The hard part is matching the boundary conditions. So that's basically what's just about the only thing that you can do analytically with these equations. And you might say, but you said linear is easy, nonlinear is hard. Well, yes, that's true. But with PDEs, it becomes only partially true. No pun intended. Because you have this complicated domain, which is not square. You know, that's what makes it hard. unavoidably hard. A PDE, generally speaking, cannot be easy. You cannot squint at it and know the answer. It's work because there's this complicated shape. And why is there a complicated shape? Well, because life has complicated shapes. And we don't care about problems if they don't come from, well, we do, we're mathematicians. But we always remember where they came from, or else what's the point? Now, this one is not a linear equation. You guys agree with me? Because if you have two solutions that satisfy this equation, and you add them together, their Laplacian will, of course, be 2f. But here, that other analogy with ODEs, well, actually, it's not an analogy with it. It's exactly what you were saying. This will be something like a particular solution that gives you f, and then anything from the null space, any harmonic function. And that's how you would probably approach solving this problem. You won't even pay attention to boundary conditions. You will just find one function whose Laplacian equals f somehow. And then you will start adding as harmonic functions and just the right combinations to match the boundary conditions. And you're sure, given that f will change them a little bit, given that the particular solution will have to adjust them a little bit. But if we approach the strategy, if we use the strategy, we don't have to worry about the part that you might think is hard when you just start looking at these, which is this part. No, that's not the hard part. Matching the boundary conditions is the hard part. Okay, this is a linear equation also. There's everything linear on the right, there's everything's linear on the left. So this will solve the same way also. We'll find one possible function that satisfies this, another, a third, a fourth, infinitely many, and then we can add them together all we want. And this condition is still satisfied. We just got to get the initial conditions and the boundary conditions and not worry about this. Once again, solution by decomposition. Same thing here. No change, right? This fundamental notion that we can find as many functions as we want that satisfy these conditions and then add them. And when I say add them, I really mean combine them in linear combinations, also multiply by numbers. All of that, this basic idea applies to all of these functions, all of them. All of them. So all of these equations, if you want to solve them analytically, you usually resort to solution by decomposition. Such an important concept. First week of linear algebra. Second week, and that's what we're still doing here today. Solution by decomposition. So the most important word is linear. Okay, so what are these little things? So these linear equations have names associated with them, which I don't like, because it's much better to say describes the equilibrium, describes slow convergence to the equilibrium, describes the rush to the equilibrium with overshoot. That's how I prefer to describe them. But they are actually called elliptic, parabolic, hyperbolic. Elliptic, you know, I wrote down the equation for the circle, but an ellipse is not that much different. It's kind of like the sum of squares equals something. And here we have the sum of second order derivatives. So it's almost like x squared plus y squared. That's why it's a metaphor, not a metaphor, but an analogy, just to find a very nice name for an equation like this. So that's why these are called elliptic. These are called parabolic because it's almost like something equals something squared, right? This is the sum of squares, and this is something, so it's almost like y equals x squared in some analogy. So these are called parabolic. And these are, of course, something like a square on the right, a square on the left. So instead of adding together squares, we're subtracting squares. And so these are called hyperbolic because that's the equation of a hyperbola. And now I'll sort of remind you of another point that I made you, how one sign can make all the difference in the world in PDEs. So a little bit of a formal, I'll just make sort of a formal point. So this is Laplace's equation, right? It's elliptic. It describes a snapshot in time. I maintain that it is hard to solve, because you don't know where to start. You don't have anywhere to start. You have to do it all simultaneously. right? And the moment you do this, it becomes a wave equation. Describes the rush to the equilibrium with overshoot. And so it's not surprising that they're completely different problems. When you study PDEs, your specialization is much more narrow than this. You wouldn't say, I'm an expert in hyperbolic equations. That's too broad. You're an expert in a much finer subset of a particular kind of equation. So that's the world of PDEs. And it's not mysterious why a minus sign makes all the difference in the world. How you approach the problem, how you think about the problem, the sorts of things you'll find. Okay? So these are the three fundamental types of linear PDEs. And so I think we'll be spending the bulk of our time with these equations.